Hello, and welcome to the Movie Universe. I'm your host, Movie Fan. Today, I got a very special dare to compare for you, because today, I'll be comparing two legendary films, the legendary 1956 classic, The Ten Commandments, versus the equally legendary 1998 film, The Prince of Egypt. Now, this is a very special dare to compare because, to the best of my knowledge, only one person has ever dared try to do this, and that would be the Nostalgia Critic. However, this is too big for only one person to do. So, I've invited my good friends, Johnathan the Reviewer, Alpha Lion Simba, the one, the only, and the beautiful, Bonnie from Joy Unicycle, and Joshua Oro to help me out. The floor is yours, everyone.
Hi, everyone. Johnathan the Reviewer here. And I'm happy to be here to team up with Movie Fan, Alpha Lion Simba, Bonnie from Joy Unicycle, and Joshua Oral, the Mustang Prince.
Hey guys, it's me again. How y'all doing? So good to see you.
Hey everybody, I'm Joshua Oro, the Mustang Prince, host of Mustang Prince OR Reports.
Hey guys! What's up? Alpha Lion Simba here, and I'm back on the Movie Universe's channel.
Now, in order to do this Dare to Compare, we're going to be doing it similar to how I've done the Batman and Robin movie versus the Green Lantern movie, or the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles holiday special versus the god-awful Star Wars holiday special. And what I mean by that is we'll be comparing the plots of each movie, the characters, the music, and so on and so forth.
So glad that we're finally doing a Dare to Compare with a good set of movies instead of a Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles versus Star Wars Holiday Special. The less we talk about that, the better.
You're right, Bonnie. I say that it's for the best to not bring up or mention both We Wish You a Turtle Christmas and mostly the Star Wars Holiday Special. And so to quote Nick Nocturne from the YouTube channel of Nightmind, when he mentioned a movie of Blair Witch 2 Book of Shadows during his review of the 2016 film of Blair Witch, forget it exists, most people have. Or in this case, forget they exist, most people have.
Now when we do The Prince of Egypt, I can go into great detail about that because I have seen that a million times. In fact, it's one of my favorite animated films. But with the Ten Commandments, I'll only be going by memory because I've seen it only once and it was in sixth grade.
Now, before we can really get started into comparing, I must give you a little background as to how it all started. Believe it or not, it all started in 1923 when a legendary director named Cecil B. DeMille filmed a movie called The Ten Commandments. He filmed it in California. And from what I've read, it was a pretty good success for the time. Then in the 50s, for reasons that are not completely clear, Cecil B. DeMille decided to remake The Ten Commandments. And a little known fact is that actually there was a lot of remakes going on back in the day, mostly from the silent movies to the talkies. So that's probably one reason. Another reason is probably because of the fact that it only covers just an overview of The Ten Commandments, because it's actually done in two acts. The first act is, well, basically Moses and the Ten Commandments, how he got them and all that stuff. Whereas for the second act, it's about two brothers in what would have been the modern time, just having their different views on the Ten Commandments. One brother is religious and follows the Ten Commandments, while the other is an atheist and vows to break every one of them so he could rise up to the top. Whereas for the 1956 film, as we all know, was all about the Ten Commandments themselves, or at least the story that led up to them. Another possible reason for this is that during the 20s, the special effects were lacking quite a bit. In fact, if you watch the original 1923 version of the Ten Commandments, it's very short compared to its 1956 counterpart. And obviously, by the 50s, special effects had greatly improved by that time. So that might have been another reason, but I'm only guessing. Because the fact is, nobody really seems to know. And I've never found anything that's ever given a straight answer as to why DeMille did this in the first place. But either way, I'm glad he did, because this movie became an instant success overnight. Wouldn't you all agree?
I agree with you, movie fan. And I gotta say that I'm surprised when you mentioned that director Cecil B. DeMille made the movie of the Ten Commandments back in 1923 before he remade this movie back in 1956. And I didn't know that the 1956 movie of the Ten Commandments is a remake until just now.
Like you said, movie fan, we're comparing the 1956 Ten Commandments movie versus The Prince of Egypt, as those were two of the biggest and most well-known Moses movies compared to everything else. Both before and in between those movies being made and after, there were a few Moses movies out there, but it was a very hard story to tell in a way, because you had to consider the possibility of the special effects as well as the length of the story. And, well, Ten Commandments knew that the story of Moses was a very long one. Heck, you have four books dedicated to the story of Moses as well as the laws that were written during Moses' time. And I'm not counting Genesis because that was before Moses. So very few movies would talk about Moses and what happened with the Israelites. But we had a few. Definitely during the silent movie era, we had Moon Israel in 1924. We, of course, had the 1923 Cecil B. DeMille's Ten Commandments. We also had The Life of Moses in 1909. And we also had a few short movies as well, like Greatest Adventure Stories from the Bible, Greatest Heroes and Legends of the Bible, their versions of Moses. Though you could clearly see with the Greatest Adventure Stories from the Bible one that they clearly were copying the Cecil B. DeMille version from 1956. Just look at that robe. I mean, that is clearly from the Cecil B. DeMille movie. And it even follows the same pattern of storytelling.
You know, you're right, Bonnie. That robe from that animated film does look like the one from the 1956 film of the Ten Commandments. And I am surprised that there are a few movie adaptations of the story of Moses been made before. Not only that I haven't heard of Cecil B. DeMille's 1923 film version of the Ten Commandments, but I also haven't heard of the other films such as Life of Moses from 1909 and the 1924 film of Moon of Israel until now. The movie that I've been introduced to the story of Moses was The Prince of Egypt from DreamWorks. And then years later, I saw the 1956 film of The Ten Commandments from Paramount Pictures. And on the topic of movie adaptations of the story of Moses that have been done before, here's something that you must know. Later after that, I discovered that back in the 90s, Rabbit Ears Productions have made two anime movies based on the story of Moses. And those are Moses in Egypt, narrated by Danny Glover with music by The Sounds of Blackness, and Moses the Lawgiver, narrated by Ben Kingsley with music by Lyle Mays. If you haven't seen these two films, then I highly recommend you to check them out.
I get it. Almost every Moses story follows the same plot, which is most people were enslaved by the Pharaoh who did not know the Israelite savior Joseph going way before Moses. And when he was afraid of any possible uprising, he decided that he was going to kill all the newborn boys. And Moses, unfortunately, was one of them, so his mother was not willing for him to die. So she put him in a basket and set him on the Nile. And he was picked up by the Pharaoh's daughter and raised in the courts of the Pharaoh as an adopted Egyptian. But eventually, when he does learn of his heritage, he goes out of his way to try and save a fellow Israelite by killing another Egyptian. Unfortunately for him, he knows that that means death, so he runs away to Midian, where 40 years later, God calls him and says, "Go back to Egypt and tell Pharaoh, let my people go." And Moses reluctantly goes back, and with the help of his brother Aaron, they both confront Pharaoh and say, "Let my people go." And the Pharaoh constantly says no. And the more that Pharaoh rejects God's command to let his people go, the more he keeps sending plagues to them until Pharaoh finally relents and says, "Get out of here, go." And so they leave.
And now that we got through the preliminaries, we can move on to, well, the comparison itself. And since this is our first time doing it with our good friend Joshua Oro, I'll let him take the lead.
Now, my introduction to the Moses story, or the Exodus, was in fact the Prince of Egypt back in 1998, and back then, I didn't really understand too much about the story. But thanks to several Sunday schools, which I miss attending nowadays, along with a couple shows like Holy Moses, which I've seen at Mission Viejo Christian Church, I consider it one of the most epic Bible stories from the Old Testament. Also, for those who follow me on my channel, my friends at Musical Theater Village have done their own version of the Moses story called Promised Land, where I got to play the Pharaoh's head taskmaster, Zerah. Plus, during rehearsals back in 2007 and in 2015, we got to watch the 1956 film version of the Ten Commandments, and to me, while it was a very long movie to sit through, and I haven't watched it again ever since then, I think the story was very well told. The special effects for the time were great, and the actors all were amazing. However, between the two, I think The Prince of Egypt would have to be my favorite version. As said during my blog, which was uploaded during my third season back in 2015. And for DreamWorks' first hand-drawn animated film, before they worked on CGI comedies like Shrek, Kung Fu Panda, and others, I think they did a superb job bringing the Moses story to life. Special props to Brenda Chapman, Simon Wells, and Steve Hickner for directing. Plus, I found it pretty interesting that there were some minor alterations throughout the film, like baby Moses being found by Queen Tuya instead of the princess, Aaron not helping Moses while talking to Pharaoh, and several other things. Also, I think the voice actors are great too, like Val Kilmer as Moses, Ray Fiennes as his stepbrother Ramesses, Michelle Pfeiffer as Zipporah, Jeff Goldblum as Aaron, Sandra Bullock as Miriam, Patrick Stewart as Pharaoh Seti, Danny Glover as Jethro, and several others all do an amazing job bringing their assigned characters to life. Plus, some of my favorite scenes in the film is the part where Moses meets God through the burning bush and the Red Sea crossing. Another thing that I like about Prince of Egypt are the songs, which were put together by the legendary Stephen Schwartz, whom you folks might know for composing the songs for the Broadway musical Wicked. Some of my favorites being The Plagues, which is really intense, Look Through Heaven's Eyes, sung by Jethro, which to me is very powerful, Playing with the Big Boys Now, sung by Hotep and Hoy, which is really creepy and spine-tingling, and of course, the classical When You Believe song, sung during the end credits by Mariah Carey and the late Whitney Houston. Also, to this day, the animation for The Prince of Egypt is so good and underrated that it gives the horrible 2007 CGI Ten Commandments movie a run for its money. Also, on a side note, The Prince of Egypt was such a huge success that 2 years later, it was followed by a direct-to-video prequel called Joseph, King of Dreams.
Well said, Joshua. Because, you know, deep down, I've always loved this film, too. However, my heart always goes to the Ten Commandments. Since I'm probably the oldest one in the group, I'm probably best suited to cover this part of the story. It was quite an epic film. I remember watching it as a kid. It was one that we always watched roughly around the time of April, mostly due to the religious reasons behind it, you know the story. It was a film that really stood the test of time, and still does, in my opinion, because it is epic beyond belief. When Cecil B. DeMille decided to do this, he really pulled out all the stops. There are so many aspects that I love about this movie that, well, I'll get into later, but probably the biggest thing would have to be the cast of characters. In fact, this is one of the few star-studded movies that I actually love. For instance, we got the legendary Charlton Heston as Moses, the equally legendary Yul Brynner as Ramesses, the master of horror himself, Vincent Price, as Baka, Legendary gangster Edward G. Robinson as Dathan. Legendary actress Ann Baxter. Lily Munster herself, Yvonne DiCarlo, plays Zipporah. Deborah Padgett as Lilia. John Derrick as Joshua. Edward France as Jethro. Nina Fosh as Princess Bithia. And of course, the legendary John Carradine as Aaron. Without a doubt, this movie does have an incredible cast, and each one of them play their parts so perfectly. For instance, you got Charlton Heston with his powerful speaking as Moses.
Thus saith the Lord God of Israel, let my people go. Who are you to make their lives bitter in hard bondage? Man shall be ruled by law, not by the will of other men. You gave me this staff to rule over scorpions and serpents, but God made it a rod to rule over kings. Hear his word, Ramses, and obey.
Everything he says just really kind of just screams out that he really is the messenger of God. Nefertiti, she's beautiful, she's cunning, and she's a little conniving, which definitely lends to the character that she's been given. Obviously, Ann Baxter was the perfect choice for her. And I've been told that, believe it or not, this was the movie that really set her career. Because beforehand, she did a few films, but it was this film that really launched her star all the way up. And she became a legend almost instantly. Mostly, it was due to her costume, because as you may be able to see, it is very transparent. And you can guess what was going on in the minds of many young men at that time. What can I say? Her character was meant to be a seductress, and she played that part beautifully. Of course, it goes without saying that Yul Brynner was great as Ramesses. He's evil, he's cunning, and of course, he's not willing to yield to Moses in any way. He comes off as this tough guy who just refuses to give in until he has no other choice. And even then, he tries to get even. It's the kind of character you would expect him to be. And John Carradine, who better to play this part? Because when he comes with Moses to demand that they let the Hebrews go, he really comes out and says that you will suffer the consequences if you don't. Just take a look at this.
Obey the Lord, or he will raise his hand against the waters of the river.
Now you can see why John Carradine was chosen for this part. Because really, no one else could have done it better. Edward Gene Robinson, of course, plays Dathan really well. He's conniving, manipulative, and he's basically a traitor to his people. Because he's greedy. Of course, who better to play a guy like that than an actor who was famous for playing gangsters? Vincent Price, of course, even though his part is very short, he does come off as that evil taskmaster that you just cheer when Moses kills him. And here's an interesting fact for you. The baby in the basket is actually Charlton Heston's real-life son. How awesome is that? He actually got his son to make a little appearance in the movie. And with a cast like this, it's easy to see why it was such a great success back then. And why it stood the test of time the way it has. Wouldn't you all agree?
That is surprisingly awesome to know that Charlton Heston brought his son to play Moses as a baby in the basket, while he played grown-up Moses in this movie. And of course, this is way before Angelina Jolie brought her daughter to play 5-year-old Aurora while she played the title character in Disney's Maleficent. In my opinion, while I enjoyed the cast from The Ten Commandments, I say that The Prince of Egypt had such an extraordinary cast. The voice cast in this movie were Val Kilmer as Moses, Ralph Fiennes as Ramesses, Michelle Pfeiffer as Zipporah, Jeff Goldblum as Aaron, Sandra Bullock as Miriam, and Steve Martin and Martin Short as Hotep and Hoy. Other cast members include Patrick Stewart as Pharaoh Seti, Helen Mirren as the Queen, Danny Glover as Jethro, and the late Ovra Haza as Yocheved from the beginning of the film. These guys did a wonderful job in their roles, and I enjoyed their voices as the characters.
Comparing these characters is almost like comparing apples and oranges because they're so good in their own way. You really like them or you really hate them or a little bit of both, depending on which character it is. But let's start by comparing Moses. In the Ten Commandments, he starts off as an instant leader. You see him as conqueror of Ethiopia and almost very close to being the heir of the throne. And then he finds out, I was born a slave. Okay, that's still cool. I'm still human. And then he gets caught by the Pharaoh and banished. And he's like, okay, this is my life. This is what it is. If only I could have delivered to the people. And then God comes and he's like, tell Pharaoh, let my people go. He's like, I'll do it. Whereas with the Prince of Egypt, yeah, he's kind of second heir to the throne. But I actually like how he and Ramses are brothers and are treated like brothers. They're rivals, but at the same time, they really deeply love each other. So if Ramses gets in trouble with Pharaoh, Moses is there to get him out of trouble, only to get him in trouble again. And then he finds out that he's not the son of Pharaoh and that he is actually born of a slave. And he takes it very hard, almost in complete shock that his entire life was a lie. The man he called father is a murderer. And so he runs away after killing an Egyptian and decides, I'm never going back to that lifestyle again. And God says, tell them, let my people go. He's like, please, no, 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 no. And God says, I will be with you. And you see Moses grow from there. And personally, this is why I like Prince of Egypt Moses better, because you see him grow from this. Sure, Ten Commandments Moses does grow, but at the same time, it feels like he was always there the whole time. Like he was always the leader. He was always destined for this greatness. Only now it comes from God. And, well, to be honest, he does seem like the kind of guy who doesn't really need Aaron to be there speaking for him. Whereas in Prince of Egypt, he looks like he needs somebody to support him and help him. Yeah, this is probably not what we want to see from a great leader, but at the same time, it kind of feels a little more realistic. This is the guy you can relate to, and you could say to yourself, maybe I can be like that one day. Maybe not lead people across the Red Sea, but maybe I could be just as great a leader despite whatever I'm going through. So I guess it's the personal preference for how you feel about it, but that's why I like Prince of Egypt Moses better. Comparing Ramses, I have to say that the Prince of Egypt wins again. Don't get me wrong, I love Yul Brynner. I think he's a great actor. I love his personality. I love the way that he gets across how evil and slimy this character is.
Et cetera, et cetera, et cetera.
You know I had to do that, guys. You know I had to do that. But besides that, he's just too evil for me. There's nothing wrong with Ramses being evil, obviously. He's pretty much described that way. But at the same time, you kind of get from this Ramses that he's never going to back down, that he's got no remorse about anything. He doesn't seem like the kind of guy who grew up with Moses, except in absolute hate. Whereas in Prince of Egypt, they absolutely grow up together. They have fun together. They tease each other. They race together. They get in trouble together. But they also make up together. And you kind of grow up with them in a way when watching this movie. Yeah, it's short, but you get the feeling that these brothers absolutely love each other and will do anything for each other and, well, also get each other in trouble. And also, when it comes time for both of them to be tested, you really feel for this Ramses in a way, because when he finds out that Moses has come back from the dead, in a manner of speaking, and finds out that he's not there to reclaim his place as Prince of Egypt, but rather to be, in a way, his enemy, he's heartbroken, he's angry, he's betrayed. It's like his brother has turned on him, and you feel for both brothers in different ways. You don't feel hatred towards Ramses. You just want Ramses to just let the Hebrews go, just so that none of this could happen anymore, and there could be some reconciliation between the two. But there can't be. And, well, with Ten Commandments, you do not get that whatsoever. You just keep saying, oh, can this Pharaoh please just die already? So Prince of Egypt wins because this Ramses, for lack of a better word, he's more human.
Now then, let's talk about the big bad of the Exodus story, Ramses. First up, I'm going to start with the actors who played him in both versions of the story. In the Ten Commandments, he's played by Yul Brynner, best known as the King from The King and I, while in The Prince of Egypt, he's voiced by Ray Fiennes, who is best known as Lord Voldemort from Harry Potter. And I have to admit, both of them actually do very good with playing Ramesses. Brennard actually does a pretty good job playing a cold-hearted dictator, while Fiennes does a great job at a character who's conflicted between family and duty. Now that that's out of the way, I can talk about the portrayals of the characters themselves. With Ramesses and the Ten Commandments, it starts off very well, because it clearly establishes that from the get-go, Moses and Ramesses were rivals, both to please Seti and for the affections of Nefertiti. But after Moses gets banished, and when he comes back, it starts to go downhill from there. And from then, Yul Brynner's Ramesses goes from an interesting character to just your stereotypical cold-hearted dictator. I mean, I still say that Yul Brynner did a good job, but the way the character is executed, it just feels like we're just going through the motions because this is a story we've known for thousands of years. Now, as for the Prince of Egypt's portrayal of Ramesses, it clearly shows that since the beginning of the movie, the two were close brothers and had a very good friendship with each other. In fact, when Moses runs away after killing a man, Ramesses is practically begging for Moses to stay, showing that regardless of what he did, he still loved him nonetheless.
I will make it so it never happened.
Nothing you can say can change what I've done.
I am Egypt, the morning and the evening star. If I say day is night, it will be written. And you will be what I say you are. I say you are innocent.
What you say does not matter. You don't understand. I can't stay here any longer.
Moses!
No! All I've ever known to be true is a lie. I'm not who you think I am.
What are you talking about?
Go ask the man I once called father.
And when Moses came back, Ramesses was ecstatic, at first thinking that they could be brothers again. But, sadly, because of Moses' new mission, this cannot happen. And this actually makes for very good conflict in the story, because Moses and Ramesses still clearly want to be brothers, but they know that that can never happen due to Moses' desire to free the Israelites and Ramesses' desire to live to his father's legacy. But what makes Ramesses in the Prince of Egypt work is that he's more emotional, more torn apart. In fact, there's this very strong, quiet moment between Moses and Ramesses very shortly after the plague song, where they're talking, where they both reminisce on old times, and where Ramesses directly asks Moses,
"Why can't things be the way they were before?"
So that's what makes him more of a three-dimensional character than Yul Brynner's Ramesses. So, again, I'm gonna have to give the point to the Prince of Egypt.
In my opinion, I'm gonna have to go with the Prince of Egypt. Because while Yul Brynner did make a great performance, don't get me wrong, I say that Ralph Fiennes made a brilliant performance as Ramesses. Like Alpha Lion Simba and Bonnie said, Yul Brynner's Ramesses does go from an interesting character into just a typical cold-hearted dictator. In The Prince of Egypt, Ramesses is more human, full of emotions and conflict between family and duty. Everything that both Bonnie and Alpha Lion Simba said about the differences between performances of Yul Brynner and Ralph Fiennes as Ramesses, I agree 100%. So yes, I say that the winner goes to the Prince of Egypt.
But of course, this can't be an Exodus movie without our main man, Moses. Now this was one I was going to have as a tie, but after some serious thought, I'd have to change the score. Let's talk about the Ten Commandments, Moses. Now don't get me wrong, Charlton Heston did a fantastic job portraying Moses. He was able to play a fearless leader very well. And we do get some vibes from that within the character.
However, much like Ramesses, there's a lot of parts where it feels more like we're just going through the motions. And we really never see much of his thoughts about what's going on around him, other than him trying to fight back any feelings for Nefertiti. But really, it starts to feel like every other Moses we'd come to see from that point. And what about the Prince of Egypt's portrayal of Moses? Well, again, just like with Ramesses, the Prince of Egypt's Moses is more human-like, where yeah, he's determined and he has leadership, but at the same time, he also shows a sense of vulnerability because he had very recently found out his true heritage and he's reluctant to try and lead these people because he was afraid they would reject him, given that he was raised by the very man who slaughtered their children. Not to mention, it explicitly is stated during the plague song that the pain and devastation that the Egyptians are going through tortures Moses inside, that he gets no pleasure about seeing those he grew up with suffer. And probably the most human part of this version of Moses was very shortly after the final plague. Right after he leaves Ramesses, he breaks down in tears. Like I said, all the pain and devastation he saw tortured him, but it seems that the death of a kid he would have regarded as his nephew seemed to have been the final straw. So yeah, like with Ramesses, I'm going to have to give the point of Moses to the Prince of Egypt for having a more human portrayal.
I'm also going to have to go with the Prince of Egypt. Don't get me wrong, Charlton Heston did a magnificent job as the character. But on the other hand, Val Kilmer made a brilliant performance as Moses. In the Ten Commandments, it does show us how great Moses was as a leader. However, it's like we're just going through the motions because this is the story that we've known from many years ago. As for Val Kilmer's portrayal of Moses in The Prince of Egypt, like Ralph Fiennes' portrayal of Ramesses, he's more human. In the first act, Moses was strong and confident, but not mature. But then he became modest in the second act, especially that he cared about his brother Ramesses. In the moment after Moses and Zipporah returned to Egypt, and before he told Ramesses about God's command of letting the Hebrews go, Moses said to Ramesses,
"In my heart you are my brother, but things cannot be as they were."
I feel the same thing, Alpha Lion Simba, about that it is stated that during the Song of the Plagues, that all of this pain and devastation tortures him inside to see the Egyptians suffer. In fact, there's this moment that while Moses warned Ramesses about the final plague, not only that he warned him, but also he begged Ramesses to stop because he doesn't want him to lose his son.
"Ramesses, your stubbornness is bringing this misery upon Egypt. It would cease if only you would let the Hebrews go."
"I will not be dictated to. I will not be threatened. I am the morning and the evening star. I am Pharaoh."
"Something else is coming. Something much worse than anything before. Please, let go of your contempt for life before it destroys everything you hold dear. Think of your son."
"I do. You Hebrews have been nothing but trouble. My father had the right idea about how to deal with your people.
Ramesses.
And I think it's time I finished the job."
"Ramesses."
"And there shall be a great cry in all of Egypt, such as never has been or ever will be again."
I also agree with you, Alpha Lion Simba, about what happened after the final plague. Seeing Moses breaking down in tears is the most human part in this version of the character. Like Ramesses, everything that both you and Bonnie said about the differences between performances of Charlton Heston and Val Kilmer as Moses, I agree 100%. So I say the winner goes to the Prince of Egypt.
And now, let's talk about the rest of the cast. Now, with the Ten Commandments, there's only one name in it that I'm actually familiar with, aside from Yul Brynner and Charlton Heston, and that would be Vincent Price, who plays Baca. He plays the part very well, but his role is pretty brief. Really, the only two side characters that really do a whole lot for me are Seti and Nefertiti. Seti plays the part of a father figure very well, although it's still made pretty clear of what the monster he was, whereas Nefertiti still serves as sort of a temptress to Moses in the second act, and it's kind of interesting to see her love for Moses morph to pure hatred. Not to mention, is she attractive? But some of the other side characters, like Lilia and Joshua, don't really do a whole lot for me, and like I said, their subplots get in the way of what the main story should be, which is why the Ten Commandments ended up being too complicated for me. But what about the Prince of Egypt? We got a star-studded cast here. As we all know, Moses and Ramesses are played by Val Kilmer and Ralph Fiennes respectively, but even the side characters have star-studded casts. We get Helen Mirren as Queen Tuya, Patrick Stewart as Seti, Steve Martin and Martin Short as Hotep and Hoy, Michelle Pfeiffer as Zipporah, Sandra Bullock as Miriam, and Jeff Goldblum as Aaron. All of them do great with who they're supposed to be. And I have to say, Patrick Stewart gave a great performance as Seti, especially when he had to deliver the line,
"Oh, my son. They were only slaves."
Even rewatching the film as an adult, that is one of the most bone-chilling lines I've ever heard in a film. And the good thing about the side characters is that they don't take up too much screen time. The only negatives with the side characters are Hotep and Hoy and Zipporah's sister, mainly because I feel more like they were there just to provide laughs and, well, The Prince of Egypt isn't a comedy, and I think Animat said it best. The comedy feels more like it felt it was something out of a family sitcom. But to be fair, at least Hotep and Hoy do get their creepy moments, and Zipporah's sisters don't really appear a whole lot in the film to really get under your skin. But as for the other side characters, I feel like they have more of a purpose. Like with Miriam serving as emotional support for Moses, with a little help from Zipporah, of course, and the voice of reason encouraging the Hebrews to believe in Moses. And what's best is that these characters are likable and they don't get in the way of the main plot. They keep more of the focus on the conflict between Moses and Ramesses, and it leaves more time for development. So it's definitely a case of less is more. So I'm gonna have to give the point to the Prince of Egypt. But I must say, and this is a bit of trivia, Val Kilmer actually had a dual role. As we all know, he did voice Moses, but he was also the voice of God. So now I can pass it on to the others.
Well said, guys. And, you know, that brings me to one important aspect of any movie, and that would have to be the plot. Now, granted, it may seem rather insignificant to try to compare the plots because, well, they're very similar. As we all know, the main story is how Moses becomes the messenger for God and frees his people. Both movies do have that, and they both do it extremely well. No doubt about that. However, the Ten Commandments does have something that Prince of Egypt doesn't, and that would be few subplots. The subplots, of course, would be the story of Yul Brynner and Nefertiti and Moses, the whole fact that she loves Moses and she hates Ramesses, but Ramesses wants her all to himself because, well, you know, he plans to be Pharaoh and all that. And then, of course, you got the story of Dathan, who is a Jew, but he's a traitor. And, of course, you got the subplot of Lilia and Joshua, with Dathan and Baca mixed into it because, you know, Baka wanted her for himself to be his little mistress there. And Dathan, pretty much the same story. So, yeah, you got some subplots there. Now, obviously, the Prince of Egypt never really had any subplots. In fact, it was very straightforward. Almost a straight line, in fact. Because there was no Joshua, no Dathan even, and no Lillian. So, therefore, there were no subplots. And that's not the only way these movies differ. Because at the very end of The Prince of Egypt, as we all know, it ends with Moses bringing down the Ten Commandments. Whereas for the Ten Commandments, well, obviously it got that name for a reason, right? So, of course, they had to tell the story about how Moses goes up to Mount Sinai to get the Ten Commandments. And, of course, it's written right before his eyes. And he brings them down, only to realize that Dathan has corrupted a lot of the people, and they all built a false idol. So, they pay the price for it. And they wandered the desert for 40 years. And that's where those two differ the most, because like I said before, in Prince of Egypt, it just ends with him bringing down the Ten Commandments, and they leave it at that. Whereas for, well, the Ten Commandments, they went forward with that part of the story. Of course, there is one thing I definitely have to mention on how different these two movies are, and that would be the fact that The Ten Commandments has a narrator, while The Prince of Egypt does not. How it goes with The Ten Commandments is, you have a narrator speak about certain events that happen in the story to paint a broader picture, and it doesn't happen very often, just only in certain key points. I'll give you a few examples of the narration.
And God said, let there be light. And there was light. And Moses took his wife and his son, and he returned to the land of Egypt. And Moses took the rod of God in his hand. And the Lord's anger was kindled against Israel. And to prove whether they would keep his commandments or no, he made them wander in the wilderness 40 years.
And that's pretty much how it goes. Now, obviously with Prince of Egypt, because it was a very straightforward story, they didn't really need the narration. They just let the actors and, of course, the action do the talking. Whereas for the Ten Commandments, because of how broad and complicated it was, and they were obviously trying to be biblical about it, so you could see why they quoted those verses from the Bible. And here's an interesting little fact for you. The narration was done by Cecil B. DeMille himself. That's right. Cecil B. DeMille was our narrator.
And that's one thing I think is really cool about the Ten Commandments. Cecil B. DeMille not only being the narrator, but introducing the story also, almost like a Shakespeare play. The movie literally starts after the overture with him standing in front of the curtains, almost like he's going to introduce something from Shakespeare, except in this case, it's much bigger than Shakespeare. Personally, I don't really have that much of a preference on what kind of plot I prefer, because both Ten Commandments and Prince of Egypt do a great job with what they're given. Ten Commandments is actually one of the few movies that has subplots that I'm just as interested in as much as the main plot that's supposed to be going on. I like the subplot with Lilia, Joshua, and Dathan just as much as I love the story of Moses. I also love the subplot with Nefertiti and Moses. Because these are engaging characters, you want to know more about them. You want to see how everything wraps up for them, and for the most part, everything wraps up satisfactorily for them, for better or for worse. And with Prince of Egypt, it's a straight story, like you said, and it focuses on one plot. Moses. Nothing else. They'll go to a few characters every now and then, but they're not the focus as much as Moses and his brother Ramses. So, yeah, I personally have no preference because both of them are engaging stories, and you want to know what's going to happen. You want to know how it's going to wrap up. Even when you know the story itself, you're still engaged with it.
In terms of the plot, well, you know the drill. Moses grows up in Egypt, Israelites enslaved, Moses runs away to Midian, and meets God at the burning bush, who instructs him to free the Hebrews from the Egyptian slavery. In terms of faithfulness to its source material, it actually does quite good in both versions, but going off of memory, I'm gonna have to dock points from the Ten Commandments. While it is a faithful adaptation of the story, the story can get a little too complicated for me when I was watching the Ten Commandments in sixth grade, because there's quite a lot of subplots, like Moses and Ramesses competing for Nefertiti's affections, and her trying to win back Moses after he married Zipporah, plus the whole thing of Joshua getting a love interest who ultimately ends up being a house slave for an Egyptian nobleman. And sometimes there's more subplots and it's just too much. And the story gets a little too complicated for me because of those subplots. Plus, I thought the ending was a little too long. I mean, hence the title of the film, it does end with Moses getting the Ten Commandments. But they extend it for too long to include the golden calf. And given that I'm autistic, I have a very, very limited attention span. So yeah, I kind of zone out the second they start with the golden calf. The Prince of Egypt, due to its time constraints, because, you know, it's a kid's movie, there's only so much you can do with it, it has much better pacing because there's fewer subplots. And the only focus is on the conflict between Moses and Ramesses, and most of the other characters like Miriam and Zipporah, they're mostly kept to the sides. Again, better pacing, and it has a better ending because it just ends with Moses giving the Ten Commandments to the Hebrews. Again, simpler. So, in terms of the plot, I'm gonna have to give points to The Prince of Egypt, because I think it did it better with better pacing and a much simpler story.
In my opinion, even though that the plot in the movie of The Ten Commandments is very well told, and I enjoy it for what it is, especially the side plots involving characters like Nefertiti and Joshua. Therefore, I would say that the winner is The Prince of Egypt, because like movie fan and Bonnie said, it's a straightforward story that focuses on both Moses' relationship with his brother Ramesses, his journey, and his mission of freeing the slaves from Egypt. I also believe that The Prince of Egypt wins because this is the plot that I always enjoy so much, and it's one of those movies that I consider perfect to watch, not needing additional side plots.
And of course, with two great movies like this, you definitely have to have one very important thing to bring it all to life, and that would be special effects. Now, I've said that special effects aren't everything, but when you talk about certain aspects, like the plagues and all that, of course, you've got to have special effects in order for that to work. You can't just say that it happened and call it a day. That really doesn't work for people. In fact, even on the stage, as many of us will know, if you don't have that certain special effects going on there, it doesn't really draw you into the story as well, because just talking about it isn't enough. For the special effects involved with the Ten Commandments, you could see a lot of great stuff going on here, like for instance when Moses turns the river to blood. Obviously right there, you're seeing some real great work done on that. Everything was colored red. Of course, it does kind of fall a little short when you're watching the Nile completely covered with the blood, because for that you could tell it's clearly superimposed. And then of course you got the scene with the burning bush. For me, it's actually pretty incredible to watch, because of the way it just kind of glows, almost like a halo kind of look. I do love that aspect, but I'll admit it doesn't exactly have the burning quality about it. And of course, you got the legendary Pillar of Fire, which obviously, it's all hand-drawn animation, which I think is pretty cool, just because, you know? Back then, obviously trying to control fire and to make it go in a tornado, well, that there's no way you could really pull that off in real life. So it's easy to see why they had to do it like this. And who could forget the so-called Angel of Death, which came to smite the firstborn. It's eerie, it's ghostly even, it's green. Very impressive, very impressive. And of course, who can forget the biggest, most incredible moment for the movie of the Ten Commandments? And that would be when Moses parts the Red Sea.
The Lord of Hosts will do battle for us. Behold his mighty hand.
Even after seeing it as many times as I have, I still love it. And of course, you know, you got the final moment where God writes the Ten Commandments. The special effects in the Ten Commandments had reigned supreme for 42 years until the Prince of Egypt came around. And I still think they have value because, you know, given what they had going on at the time, it's still very well done. And even if the special effects are dated, I still love them. They still reign supreme to me. And, you know, just think about this. They did this back in 1956, and back then, you know, you didn't have CGI and all that, so you had to get creative. And pretty much I think I've covered just about all the special effects on the Ten Commandments, except for maybe one minor detail, and that would be the fact that even though I don't know if this classifies as a special effect, it still kind of counts to me because it is of great importance. And that's the fact that this movie was shot almost entirely on location. When they made this movie, they actually filmed it in Egypt, in the desert, and of course, at Mount Sinai. And that's a very big deal to actually film right there. Because obviously filming on location, it's not cheap. And it's not easy to do because, you know, when the weather acts up, you're at its mercy. And then, of course, there's, you know, legal rights to film in certain places. You know how it is. And contrary to popular belief, it is also very expensive. And I'm sure there was quite a few scenes that were shot in L.A. There had to be. But most of it was definitely filmed on location. And that's a very big deal. Wouldn't you all agree?
Well, I definitely agree, movie fan. And looking back at the Ten Commandments, some of the effects do hold up. And, well, the effects for the Red Sea actually were somewhat recycled from the original 1923 movie. I mean, nowadays you could kind of tell how they did it, which they were really pouring a bucket of water and rewound the action, which I think is very impressive, and the way they did it is really cool. But any of the effects that involve God, unfortunately, I think are just too dated. Yeah, the Pillar of Fire is 2D animation, but when you compare that Pillar of Fire to the Pillar of Fire in the Prince of Egypt, it looks a lot more cartoony than the actual cartoon. And in all honesty, the Egyptians don't look like they're interacting with that Pillar of Fire. It doesn't look like it's really there. You can interpret it in any way you want, but it really did not look like that they were blocked by that Pillar of Fire. I still love the Red Sea effect, and I especially love that this was one of those movies that were really committed to all the stunts, the effects, and so forth, and being filmed on location, like you said. And especially nowadays, with constant CGI after constant CGI, and staying in Hollywood for filming, it's a bit of a rarity to see it nowadays. But as great as the effects for the Ten Commandments were, the effects for the Prince of Egypt were even more amazing. There was no fooling, no tricking around. You directly see it happen. So you see all the plagues. You don't just hear about it off screen. You see the Red Sea open up in a pretty original way, actually. Before then, not many people would have thought of the water splashing upwards like that. Most of the times, people would have the imagery of the Red Sea parting like that, instead of like a fountain. Some of the designs they kept from the original Ten Commandments, like the Pillar of Fire, still looks like it is from Ten Commandments, only this time it's enhanced with CGI, and it looks a lot more impressive and intimidating to look at and to be in the presence of. And on top of that, the Egyptians do look like they cannot get around it. and that they're troubled by it. Whereas in Ten Commandments, I didn't really buy it. Also, the Angel of Death also looks pretty ghostly. When I was a kid and I saw it, I wasn't sure what it was. I thought it was just the wind. And it kind of behaves almost like the wind, except in this case, it's a breathtaker, literally, like in showing in this scene. And when you find out that this is the Angel of Death, you become scared. The green smoke in the Ten Commandments was also scary for the fact that it could slowly come for you next. But there was no time wasting with this one. For the most part, I have no complaints about the special effects for Prince of Egypt, because for what they had in 1998, it is really, really cool to behold. And to be fair, so was it in the 1950s. But if I had to choose one winner, I'm gonna have to go with Prince of Egypt, because everything in there looked absolutely impressive.
On one hand, the special effects in the Ten Commandments are very good. And two of the best scenes with amazing use of special effects are when Moses was parting the Red Sea, and the scene when God writes the Ten Commandments. On the other hand, the special effects in The Prince of Egypt are fantastic. Also, the animation is incredible, and I love it so much. The special effects for the scenes of the plagues are remarkable, such as water turning into blood, fiery hail, and the Angel of Death. I especially love the special effects for both the burning bush, the pillar of fire, and the Red Sea. Like Disney Renaissance movies such as Beauty and the Beast, Aladdin, The Lion King, and The Hunchback of Notre Dame, the animation in this movie is combined with hand-drawn and CGI. Again, the Ten Commandments may have very good special effects, and there are moments that have amazing use of special effects, don't get me wrong. But with brilliant special effects and animation like this, I say The Prince of Egypt is definitely a winner.
Also, I must mention a certain fun fact. I find it pretty smart that Jeffrey Katzenberg had several biblical scholars, Christian, Jewish, Muslim theologians, and Arabian American leaders as advisors to help his film be more accurate and faithful to the original story. Also, unlike the Ten Commandments, which features narration, I like that during the beginning of The Prince of Egypt, it shows an on-screen description foreshadowing the film that we, the audience, are about to watch. And now, let me talk about the animation for The Prince of Egypt. As we all know, this was DreamWorks' very first animated film before they made such beloved films like Spirit, Stallion of the Cimarron, The Road to El Dorado, Sinbad, Legend of the Seven Seas, and before they made such beloved CGI films like Shrek, Kung Fu Panda, Madagascar, How to Train Your Dragon, and others. Anyway, I still think the hand-drawn animation for The Prince of Egypt is absolutely amazing. And I'm surprised that this movie took approximately 4 years to put together. Plus, it's been quite a long time since I read a book about the animation history during my high school age. What I find interesting about the animation is that the team included 350 artists from 34 different nations. Many of them were primarily recruited both from Walt Disney Feature Animation and from Steven Spielberg's Emblemation. And to me, these guys have done remarkable at capturing the setting of Old Testament Egypt and depicting the ethnicities of the ancient Egyptians, the Hebrews, and the Nubians properly. Fun fact, the characters were animated with the digital paint software Amino by Cambridge Animation, now merged with Toon Boom Technologies, and the compositing of the 2D and 3D elements were done using the Exposure Tool, a digital solution developed by Elias Research by Silicon Graphics. Additional fine line animation was outsourced to Bardell Entertainment, Fox Animation Studios, and Heart of Texas Productions. Plus, there were approximately 934 hand-painted backgrounds and 1,180 scenes in the movie contained work by the special effects department, which animated everything that was not a character, like blowing wind, dust, rainwater, shadows, etc. Also, a blend of traditional animation and computer-generated imagery were used in the depictions of the 10 plagues of Egypt and the parting of the Red Sea. Also, aside from those scenes, I thought the animation used for Moses' hieroglyphic dream sequence seemed not only very complicated to animate, but it was still very thought-provoking, especially when Moses sees his biological family taking him to the Nile River and placing him in a basket. And I still think the moment where Moses speaks to God through the burning bush was a very powerful and tear-jerking scene, especially when we hear voices from the past.
Stop it! Leave that man alone!
And I think the way Val Kilmer voices God is both soft and booming. Plus, the reason why Kilmer was chosen was in order to indicate that God was communicating to him via the voice he would otherwise perceive in his mind, as opposed to the larger-than-life tones used to portray God in previous theatrical releases. Also to note, the animation team took trips to Egypt, the Sinai Peninsula, and Death Valley, California for animation sketches and research, which feels very similar to what the animation teams for The Lion King, The Rescuers Down Under, and The Hunchback of Notre Dame did. Also, does anyone remember this stone face of Pharaoh Seti? Well, this may not seem like a big deal, but I found it pretty cool that my friends from Musical Theater Village used this stone face during shows like Promised Land and Joseph and the Amazing Technicolor Dreamcoat.
Now, we move on to the special effects, starting with the Ten Commandments. From what I've heard, the Ten Commandments was the most expensive film at the time, and I gotta say, budget is pretty well spent. Now, we don't see too much action, boom stuff like we do nowadays, but for what they managed to do with special effects, it does well. We don't see a whole lot of the plagues because, well, you know, budget and that kind of thing. But of the plagues we do see, when the river turns to blood, it looks like real blood. And when the angel of death comes to take away all the firstborn, gives off some pretty creepy vibes. Then again, it was kind of meant to do that. And the way they use God in the special effects perfectly matches the tone of the film and the way it's supposed to portray God. In fact, when God's carving out the Ten Commandments, that looks bloody great. And I was legitimately terrified when the earth tore in two after Moses threw the Ten Commandments. So yeah, now for the Prince of Egypt. Now, any of you who are familiar with my channel know that I've always been a sucker for animated films, and when it comes to The Prince of Egypt, I gotta say, that film's animation is a thing of beauty. It's one of the best-looking hand-drawn animated films I've ever seen, right up there with The Lion King, which is saying quite a lot. I mean, really, the backgrounds in Egypt are gorgeous. I can definitely tell that the animators at DreamWorks went to actual location to paint all that scenery. And some of the effects were CGI, like the part of the scene where Moses and Ramesses race in their chariots, that's made from CGI. And of course, the parting of the Red Sea. They look great, and it's great examples of using CGI when it's actually necessary, rather than just because you can't. Now, as for the character animation, it is fantastic, with the Egyptian characters, mostly the side characters,
it mostly perfectly matches ancient Egyptian hieroglyphics. And at one point, the film actually takes that hieroglyphics thing literally when Moses has that nightmare. It looks like moving hieroglyphics. It looks amazing. So, for the final score for special effects, I think I'm going to have to make this one a tie.
And now, we come to the moment that I think you've all been waiting for. And that would be the plagues. Now, with the Ten Commandments, given what they had to work with back in 1956, they had to get creative. And they did. For instance, when they turned the Nile into blood, obviously it's a simple dye job. And of course, the Angel of Death, obviously it's green smoke that is lofting in the sky and then lofting on the ground. Very impressive work. And the hail, well, you know, there's an old trick to make it rain, so obviously they did the same thing here. And as for the fire that was coming from the hail, it was just superimposed. And those scenes are absolutely great. I just love watching, especially to watch the Angel of Death just creep out of the sky in that spooky fashion. And I'll tell you this, the music really highlighted that scene very well. And unfortunately, those three plagues are the only ones you really get to see. Because unfortunately for the rest of them, Pharaoh's advisors just mention it, and that's about it. Here, I'll show you what I mean.
They've been plagued by frogs, by lice, by flies, by sickness, by boils. They can endure no more.
Now, I can understand why they didn't bother with the frogs and the flies, because obviously, to do frogs, you know, they're hard to control. In fact, if you watch the movie E.T. when Elliot sets the frogs loose, you know, they're all over the place, and that's what would happen. And there's no way you could get the frogs to just go onto the set and do what you tell them to do. They just don't do that. And as for flies, well, that speaks for itself, you know, because you can't control flies. It's just not possible. And for boils and sores, well, I think they were worried that that might cause some nightmares. And, you know, obviously to do something like that, it would take a lot of work to do a makeup job like that on all the people. So, yeah. And sometimes, you know, the idea of it is good enough. A lot of people would say that doesn't work anymore, and maybe not, but, you know, there are times that you just gotta give the idea of what happened, rather than actually show it. Does it work for this? Well, maybe not to the best ability. But back then, it was good enough. And at the same time, I think they might have been using a little bit more of their budget for those three most memorable plagues. And now we come to probably the most interesting part of our Dare to Compare. And that would be the music. Now, I know this may seem a little crazy, because obviously with Ten Commandments, it is not a musical. Whereas for Prince of Egypt, is a musical. However, both of them do have spectacular music that really just sets the mood for everything going on. For the Ten Commandments, you know, you get this epic booming sense of power and unbelievable imagination going on here. But of course, you know, with all music, you have to really see it to understand the point. Let me give you a few examples. Now, I think most of this speaks for itself, but I'll highlight it anyway. When Moses is coming back from Ethiopia, you get this sense of power of the conquering hero returning from the war. Always epic. Very. And of course, when he's traveling through the desert, you get this sense of what is lying out there for him. And of course, when the plagues happen, you get a little back and forth on that to set the mood. For instance, when they're talking about it, and when the hail is coming, you don't hear any music. Whereas for the river turning to blood, obviously, you get a real dramatic buildup going up there.
Look! Look! There! Where he struck the river! It bleeds! The water turns to blood!
Blood flows from the god!
You shall see hail fall from a clear sky and burn as fire upon the ground.
And who can forget the music to the Angel of Death coming out of the sky? It just screams that death is coming. And when the Hebrews leave Egypt, that speaks for itself. Obviously, they're free. They could go. So they're making a triumphant exit. And of course, when the parting of the Red Sea, very dramatic, very powerful, it just screams that God is doing his work to save his people. That's the importance of that music. And like we've said before, music is a key element in any movie, and the Ten Commandments is a great example of that. As for the Prince of Egypt, well, I think I'll let my friends cover that one, because I'm pretty sure they'll cover that way better than I.
Yeah, I love the songs from Prince of Egypt, but I decided that that's not what I'm going to talk about for this segment, because, well, to be fair, Ten Commandments doesn't really have that many songs. Maybe one or two, but not really. So I'm going to talk about the instrumentals and compare them. And for the record, I'll just say, I love every song from Prince of Egypt, and they deliver on the right situations in every way. And I can't get over some of the lyrics and the rhymes. I just love them all. But it's the instrumentals that I think are the strongest part of both movies. With Ten Commandments, it was composed by Elmer Bernstein, not at all related to Leonard Bernstein, by the way. And he was a master. Before this, he had done Saturday's Hero, The Eternal Sea, and later would go on to do Airplane and Blues Brothers. So you know this is a real master. You could really tell he knew what he was doing with every moment of Ten Commandments, and you feel the hero's journey in every moment of it. Whether the grand entrance of Moses when he returns from Ethiopia, the hardship and yet the grandeur of what was going on in Egypt, and when he enters the presence of God for the first time, and when he's finally leading the Exodus out of Egypt. It all sounds amazing. Just take a listen to this.
Put off thy shoes from off thy feet, for the place whereon thou standest is holy ground. I am the God of thy father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob.
Thank you.
I know, that sounds amazing, right? Now, what about the Prince of Egypt? Well, composed by Hans Zimmer, and you know his name for the most part, whether you've seen The Dark Knight Rises, you've seen The Da Vinci Code, Madagascar, Kung Fu Panda, and Rain Man. He pretty much was a master composer when it came to the right emotions and the right timing. And kudos to him for every single moment, whether it be the moment where Pharaoh is lecturing Moses and Ramses for their transgressions, or the racing that's going on when they're just fooling around, or when Moses has to run away, or when the Red Sea parts, or especially that burning bush moment. I've talked about this already. I get it. But good grief, that is his finest work. If you took the music out of the burning bush scene, okay, it'd be all right. You would have the really cool animation and Val Kilmer's powerful voice acting as God, as well as Moses. But when that music marries into the scene, like I said, it feels like God is leaping off the screen and surrounding you. It's amazing the way that they did it. Just listen and tell me you don't feel some kind of chill.
Take the sandals from your feet, for the place on which you stand is holy ground. I am that I am. So I have come down to deliver them out of slavery and bring them to a good land. A land flowing with milk and honey.
How can I even speak to these people?
Who made man's mouth? Who made the deaf, the mute, the seeing, or the blind? Did not I? Now go!
Oh, Moses, I shall be with you when you go to the king of Egypt. But Pharaoh will not listen. So I will stretch out my hand and smite Egypt with all my wonders.
It's that amazing. And what I like about both scores is they deliver on the right moments, and they make you feel each scene and the weight of each moment even more than when the music is off. There are moments where the music needs to be off, like, I mean, when the Angel of Death comes in The Prince of Egypt. That's called for to have no music. But like I said, if you had the burning bush scene without music, it'd be okay. But with the music, you feel it. Or this moment where Moses goes back to Egypt with Zipporah. Yeah, the moment would be okay without the music. But with the music, you feel the weight of what Moses has to do. He has to face his brother and tell him, it's not okay what you're doing. Let my people go. Otherwise, I'm bringing the wrath of God with me. Just because of how powerful the music and the animation and the situations are in Prince of Egypt, it wins. It wins for me big time. For the record, I love the music very much in Ten Commandments, but there's more of a weight to what's going on in the instrumentals in Prince of Egypt.
And now, I'd like to talk about two songs for this section. First, we have the sort of villain song, Playing with the Big Boys Now, which is sung by the Egyptian priests Hotep and Hoy when Moses requests that the Hebrews be released and he transforms his staff into a snake to demonstrate God's power. To me, this song segment is pretty interesting. While Moses possesses real magic from God, the priests are just putting on a magic show like Penn and Teller or Siegfried and Roy. It is literally all smoke and mirrors, and how they present it is very creepy and will make your spine tingle. And I think the way Steve Martin and Martin Short sing this song is very dramatic. Plus, I think Hotep and Hoy have got guts when it comes to upstaging Moses and God in a light show. However, the most memorable part of the song is when the priests recreate the snake transformation, only to have their snakes get eaten by Moses's. The second song to talk about is When You Believe, which is sung twice in the movie. Once by Miriam, Zipporah, and the other Hebrews as they leave Egypt to go to the Promised Land, and the second time is sung during the end credits by Mariah Carey and the late Whitney Houston. To me, this song is described at best as being a big ballad with meaningful and inspirational lyrics describing the ability each person has to achieve miracles when they reach out to God and believe. Also, my favorite part of each version is the children's choir led by soloist Andrew Bryan and the gospel choir during Carey and Houston's version. Also, I agree with Mariah Carey that this song really was a miracle. And I believe this song really did deserve the Academy Award for Best Original Song at the time.
Now, let's talk about the soundtrack. I can't say anything for the Ten Commandments because, well, it's not a musical, but I have a great deal to say about The Prince of Egypt. I can describe the soundtrack of this film with one word: phenomenal. Every single song is great to listen to. Deliver Us perfectly amplifies the severity of the situation the Hebrews are in. Through Heaven's Eyes perfectly demonstrates Moses' transition to Hebrew life, or Midianite life, you get what I mean. Playing with the Big Boys, dang, that song's a banger! It has really creepy undervibes in it, and hey, who knew Steve Martin could sing? But then there's The Plagues, which both perfectly amplifies the horror of the plagues and the internal turmoil going on between Moses and Ramesses. But then there's our big Oscar winner, When You Believe. That perfectly demonstrates the joy and excitement of the Hebrews at their newfound freedom. These do exactly what musicals are supposed to do: enhance the story and develop the characters in ways that dialogue can't. But it's not just the songs that make this soundtrack so memorable. It's also the score. The score was composed by the legendary Hans Zimmer, the same guy who did the score in The Lion King. And I have to say, Hans, you've done it again. Much like the songs, each scene that plays the music with the score perfectly amplifies the scene. I mean, take a listen to how the music during the burning bush scene plays out.
Who are you?
I am that I am.
I don't understand.
I am the God of your ancestors, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob.
Enough said. So, yep, The Prince of Egypt has a great soundtrack.
In my opinion, I find the music in the movie The Ten Commandments to be incredible, and Elmer Bernstein did a great job composing the music, along with two Martin Scorsese movies, Cape Fear and The Age of Innocence. But I say that The Prince of Egypt is so breathtaking, and composer Hans Zimmer deserves praise for creating this brilliant music score. And yes, I also love all of the songs in this movie by lyricist Stephen Schwartz, who previously worked on two Disney movies, Pocahontas and The Hunchback of Notre Dame. Later, he worked on the Broadway stage musical Wicked, which will soon get a movie adaptation, and he also worked on Disney's Enchanted. I remember when I was a kid watching The Prince of Egypt on VHS, and before the movie began, there was a promo about the motion picture soundtrack of the film. In my opinion, this is one of the best soundtrack promos I've ever seen. I mean, take a look at this.
Bring home the music from the motion picture soundtrack, The Prince of Egypt. Relive all the adventure with all the music, including additional performances by Casey and JoJo, Boys to Men, Amy Grant, and the Oscar-winning duet by superstars Whitney Houston and Mariah Carey. The music event of the year on DreamWorks CDs and cassettes.
Amazing, don't you think? Anyway, what I love about Hans Zimmer's music in The Prince of Egypt is the use of choir. For instance, the music of Moses and the Burning Bush is a powerful piece of music. And you must know that the beginning part of this music was used in the opening credits of the movie. I say that this is one of the most amazing music pieces that Hans Zimmer has ever done. And everything that Bonnie said about this scene, I definitely agree. I especially love when both the music and the choir fits on some moments, such as in songs like Deliver Us, Look Through Heaven's Eyes, Playing with the Big Boys Now, and When You Believe. Also, I've got to talk about the music for the scene of the plagues. While it is kind of another reprise of the song of All I Ever Wanted, it is a song that sends shivers down my spine. Because of Hans Zimmer's powerful music, the lyrics that Stephen Schwartz wrote, and of course, the way the choir sang is like, these are the words of God. I mean, take a look at this. Seriously, this scene is really chilling, and this music fits perfectly. Here's an interesting fact for you. Not only that Ofra Haiza voiced the character of Yocheved in the film, but also she did some of the vocals in the music of this movie. Here's another interesting fact for you. During the song of When You Believe in the scene when Moses and the Hebrews leave Egypt, we can hear children singing the song at the sea in Hebrew. As I said before, the music in the Ten Commandments is incredible, and it is one of Elmer Bernstein's best music scores. But in my opinion, I say that The Prince of Egypt is one of the most phenomenal music scores that Hans Zimmer has ever done. I gotta say that this is one of my favorite music scores from Hans Zimmer, along with Disney's The Lion King, Gladiator, the Pirates of the Caribbean saga, Christopher Nolan's The Dark Knight trilogy, and the Kung Fu Panda trilogy, which recently just got a fourth movie. Also, the songs written by lyricist Stephen Schwartz are both wonderful and brilliant to listen to, that you cannot get it out of your head, especially the Oscar-winning song When You Believe. In 2020, just like Shrek, The Prince of Egypt has become a new stage musical with Stephen Schwartz coming back to do the music and the songs. In 2024, the stage musical of The Prince of Egypt is released on DVD and Blu-ray. I'm looking forward to check it out, and maybe someday I will review it. So with all that said, the winner for the music category in this Dare to Compare is definitely The Prince of Egypt.
And now we're going to talk about God. This is actually a very interesting subject. And kudos to both Moses actors in both the Ten Commandments and in Prince of Egypt for voicing God. And unless you have a very good ear, you wouldn't really be able to tell. Let's start with the Ten Commandments God. voiced by Charlton Heston, who was also Moses. And personally, I couldn't tell, but I don't like it. I'm sorry, I don't like it. I give kudos to him for trying and for making his own version of God, though it's kind of the same kind of voice that most people associate God with. Booming, big, and kind of scary. And I get it, he can be scary. But there's just something about the tone that he gives that just sounds like he's muffled through a microphone. Sound quality, I don't think is good. And also, I don't really like the animation either on the burning bush or that pillar of fire. Look at what some of these other movies later did. In 1989, with the Ben Kingsley Moses, the way they set up the burning bush, I'm pretty sure that they either lit that bush and just played a loop on it so that it looked like it didn't burn, or they had some animatronic bush, lit it on fire, pretty much just let it be believable that it was an eternally burning bush. Or heck, look at what some of the stage plays do nowadays, particularly Sight and Sound theaters. What they did with that one is have an animatronic bush and make it look like it was on fire. Yeah, you could tell what the effects are, but honestly, in my opinion, it looks more plausible and more believable than what Ten Commandments did. I give them credit for a lot of their special effects and a lot of their sets, but I still think you could have lit a bush on fire, take that single clip and play it on a loop. And also, speaking of the Ben Kingsley Moses, that's another thing that I like what they did with God in there. The person voicing God in that one sounded natural. He didn't sound like he was going through a muffler and very hard to understand, like Darth Vader, except Darth Vader was easier to understand than this. And that leads us to the Prince of Egypt. It was said that Val Kilmer tried to create a different kind of God in this one, and his own version, while also trying to not be entirely recognizable. He probably is recognizable, I don't know, but when I see that moment, I don't hear Val Kilmer. I hear God. And that is attributed to not only the animation, but the music and the way it marries into the moment. It is just beautiful. But even if you took those away, Val Kilmer's voice as God just provides a sense, a presence that leaps out at you even when you're watching it, so that you feel like you are in his presence. It's amazing. And yeah, most people will say this is a more loving God, and on the one hand, yes, but on the other hand, you get the sense that this is not a tamed God either, because this God can sometimes speak in a very soft and friendly way, but at the same time have a commanding tone in him. And if he gets really angry, you get to know it, and you hear his voice being raised and the animation of the flames consuming the surrounding area where Moses is. You get terrified in that moment, just like Moses is. Because, yeah, this is the same God who brings on the 10 plagues into Egypt, but this is also the same God that is willing to deliver his people out of Egypt. And that's what I love about this version of God. Not only is he vocally expressive in The Prince of Egypt, just everything about the voice, the animation, and the music just brings a real presence out of the screen and where you are. Just look at this, listen to this, and tell me you couldn't feel that.
Take the sandals from your feet, for the place on which you stand is holy ground.
Who are you?
I am that I am. So I have come down to deliver them out of slavery and bring them to a good land. A land flowing with milk and honey.
How can I even speak to these people? Who made man's mouth? Who made the deaf, the mute, the seeing, or the blind? Did not I? Now go!
Moses, I shall be with you when you go to the king of Egypt. But Pharaoh will not listen.
So I will stretch out my hand and smite Egypt with all my wonders.
Ten Commandments, on the other hand, kudos to Charlton Heston for trying his best and doing the best he could, but this god is too monotoned. You could not tell if he was angry or happy or sad or anything. He's just too monotoned. I'll also give credit to the animators of the time who worked on it, because it must have been very hard, but I'm sorry. Prince of Egypt wins this round.
And now I can offer my two cents in on the portrayals of God. Now this one I was originally going to do again, give the point to the Prince of Egypt, but again, after some serious thought, I decided to change my opinion. Because in this case, we get both ends of the spectrum in both respective films. The Ten Commandments God perfectly matches a mighty figure that should be treated with great respect. I mean, listen to the voice.
Put off thy shoes from off thy feet, for the place whereon thou standest is holy ground.
And then there's Val Kilmer's portrayal of God, and for me, that perfectly matches the loving, merciful God that we all come to know. When you combine the two, it can become a perfect balance. So in this case, for God, it's going to be another tie.
And now we come to the most important part of the comparison, and that would be the biblical accuracies. Now, I'm not very religious. I was raised Catholic, but I never really read too much on the Bible, to be honest. However, I do know quite a few things that do need to be acknowledged. And if you watch my channel, you know I'm a bit of an amateur historian. So, whenever there's history involved, I'm interested. And I'm sure, as a lot of people would know, historians and biblical scholars have been debating about the Bible for centuries, and probably always will be. But both parties do believe that a lot of stuff did happen. So, that's where I come. Now, before we start getting into the inaccuracies, I want to remind everybody that for both films, they did acknowledge that they took an artistic license for their work. And I think I could speak for everybody when I say that we don't intend to be harsh about this. We're just telling it like it is. Because, you know, with Hollywood, there's always an artistic license involved. Very seldom, and I mean very seldom, do you see anything that is so accurate that it's literally spot on. Especially given the fact that there are certain details about Moses' life that is a little obscure. In fact, Cecil B. DeMille said it himself, and I know I played this earlier, but I'll play it for you again, just to show you my point.
This may seem an unusual procedure, speaking to you before the picture begins, but we have an unusual subject, the story of the birth of freedom. The story of Moses. As many of you know, the Holy Bible omits some 30 years of Moses' life. From the time he was a 3-month-old baby and was found in the bulrushes by Bithia, the daughter of Pharaoh, and adopted into the court of Egypt, until he learned that he was Hebrew and killed the Egyptian. To fill in those missing years, we turn to ancient historians such as Philo and Josephus. Philo wrote at the time that Jesus of Nazareth walked the earth. And Josephus wrote some 50 years later and watched the destruction of Jerusalem by the Romans. These historians had access to documents long since destroyed, or perhaps lost, like the Dead Sea Scrolls. The theme of this picture is whether men are to be ruled by God's law or whether they are to be ruled by the whims of a dictator like Ramesses. Are men the property of the state or are they free souls under God? This same battle continues throughout the world today. Our intention was not to create a story, but to be worthy of the divinely inspired story,
created 3,000 years ago. The five books of Moses.
Now, as he said, it omits 30 years of Moses' life. So they had to go through other sources of information. And he did acknowledge that some of them were written way after Moses' time. So obviously he was hinting at the idea that they may not necessarily be accurate. And that's forgivable, because, you know, when you got only so much information to work with, you know, you do the best you can. And yeah, sometimes you have to fill in a few gaps, but that's just the way it is. And here's an interesting piece of information for you. In line with the sources that Cecil B. DeMille mentioned, he also had a few others. For instance, one was a book called The Pillar of Fire by Reverend John H. Irigam. Another source was On Eagle's Wings by Reverend A.E. Southern. But the most interesting would be a book entitled Prince of Egypt by Dorothy Clark Wilson. Now, is that a coincidence for the 1998 remake? I'll let you be the judge. Either way, Cecil B. DeMille really did everything he could to try to make it as accurate as possible, or at the very least, true to the story of Moses. But he did take an artistic license, as did the Prince of Egypt, which they greatly acknowledged in the opening itself. I do know a few things about the Bible that should be mentioned in this Dare to Compare. For instance, probably the biggest one for me would be Joshua. Now, in the Ten Commandments, Joshua is literally Moses' right-hand man. Whenever something needed to be done, he was there to do it. He was even waiting for him at Mount Sinai when Moses was coming down with the Ten Commandments. And, of course, Joshua has a love interest who is pretty much taken from him by a corrupted Jew. Joshua, he's a huge part of the story. And, of course, at the end of the movie,
Joshua, Joshua, I charge you and strengthen you, for you shall go over Jordan to lead the people.
Now that's pretty much Joshua's story in the Ten Commandments. As for the Prince of Egypt, well, he doesn't exist. He's not there, not even a part of it, not even mentioned. Now, as we all know, Joshua was mentioned several times in the Bible, most notably for the Battle of Jericho. However, Joshua was actually, indeed, pretty much Moses' right-hand man. But mostly it was when they were traveling through the desert for 40 years, and he did go up to Mount Sinai with Moses, but he didn't necessarily go all the way, just like in the Ten Commandments. And when Moses relinquished his leadership, he gave it to Joshua, just like in the Ten Commandments. So the Ten Commandments is very much on par with the story of Joshua, but it's a little exaggerated. For instance, there's no mentioning of him having a love interest, and there's no mention of Dathan or the taskmasters taking Joshua's love interest, Lilia, from him. So that's obviously Cecil B. DeMille's work. I guess Cecil B. DeMille just decided to do a little bit more for him. Who knows? So for both movies, there is inaccuracies on the part of Joshua. For the Ten Commandments, obviously Joshua's role is greatly exaggerated. While the Prince of Egypt, Joshua doesn't exist. And there's another inaccuracy that's actually done by both films. And that would be the Pharaoh himself, Ramesses. And that's the fact that the Bible does not specifically say who the Pharaoh was. It's true. It really doesn't give the Pharaoh's name at all. It just says the Pharaoh. It doesn't say anyone specific. So now the question, where did they get the name Ramesses? Well, his name actually appears several times in the Bible, so that might have had influence on it. And apparently Ramesses was actually one of the most famous pharaohs of all time. I know it's hard to believe because we hear about King Tut like it was going out of style, but Ramesses actually really was one of the most famous pharaohs. So the bottom line is, we really don't know who this pharaoh was. It's possible that it could have been Ramesses, however, the jury's still out on that one. And that's pretty much all the inaccuracies that I can give. So I'm leaving it up to the rest of my friends.
And now we've come to the inaccuracies. So I'm going based off of biblical inaccuracies, though I do want to point out one possibility, because Movie Fan and I, we talked about Ramesses II not being the Ramesses that Cecil B. DeMille, Chapman, Hickerman, and Wells talked about. There is a possibility it might have been a different pharaoh, but one thing that I did see when looking up Ramesses II is that his firstborn son did die, but very likely in his 20s. And I will say, if this is the same Ramesses, I wouldn't put it past if accurately the Angel of Death took Ramesses II's son in his 20s, because Moses hid out for 40 years and came back to Egypt when he was 80. So I wouldn't put it past any possibility that it might have been the same Ramesses, and that was really his son who died. And don't forget what Ramesses said in Prince of Egypt.
I am the morning and the evening star.
Ramesses,
it shall be as I say.
Anyways, I'm going to start with 10 Commandments inaccuracies, or biblical inaccuracies in this case. I don't hate the changes that this movie made at all. I think that when a movie does take liberty license with it, they still need to be respectful of the source material. And both Prince of Egypt and 10 Commandments were respectful in their own way and created their own thing. However, there were plenty of things they fictionalized, like I don't know if Moses was conqueror of Ethiopia or not, but he was not 30 when he kills an Egyptian and left Egypt. He was 40. I don't know if that meant he was married at the time or not, but he was pretty much qualified to be a full-grown man. And it did say that he went out among his people eventually in the Bible, but it doesn't say how, so I'll let them have the possibility that he reduced himself to a slave. However, both in Ten Commandments and Prince of Egypt, Moses kills an Egyptian in full view of everybody and no time to give him a burial. And in Ten Commandments, he's caught and brought before the Pharaoh. And in Prince of Egypt, he runs off. Well, Prince of Egypt half got it right, but both of them still got it wrong, because here's what it says in Exodus chapter 2, verse 11. And don't worry, it won't be in King James Version, so know thee and thou. It'll be understandable. One day, after Moses had grown up, he went out to where his own people were and watched them hard at labor. He saw an Egyptian beating a Hebrew, one of his own people. Looking this way and that and seeing no one, he killed the Egyptian and hid him in the sand. The next day, he went out and saw two Hebrews fighting. He asked the one in the wrong, "Why are you hitting your fellow Hebrew?" The man said, "Who made you ruler and judge over us? Are you thinking of killing me as you killed the Egyptian?" Then Moses was afraid and thought, "What I did must have become known." When Pharaoh heard of this, he tried to kill Moses. But Moses fled from Pharaoh and went to live in Midian. So Prince of Egypt half got that right, but at the same time, still got it wrong. And Ten Commandments also got wrong Dathan. I don't know if Dathan ever was a taskmaster or not, but I think they chose him as the bad guy because Dathan easily gets one of the scariest punishments in the Bible, bar none. So making him the major role and making him in charge of the rebellion doesn't quite work, unfortunately, if you know the scriptures. His brother Abiram, okay, both Dathan and Abiram were Reubenites, that is, sons of Reuben. And the man that they call be a high priest for the golden calf, Korah, is very last minute and actually a waste of a character, because it was Korah who led a rebellion against Moses after they were denied entry into the promised land. That's a story for another time. But Korah was the real bad guy, and Dathan and Abiram followed in his footsteps and rebelled against Moses and Aaron for their leadership. Because of their instigating the rebellion, God punished them by letting the earth swallow them whole. You see that punishment in the Ten Commandments, but in a way it's kind of a waste. And I get it, it's to compress time, but also give him an upcoming punishment that was so well deserved. Still inaccurate nonetheless. But to be fair, they did make Dathan a pretty slimy character in this one. So kudos to making him a character at all. But I'll also say that Dathan did not suggest setting up the gold calf at all. It was a group effort among the people. And it's very likely that he would not have been in charge of that Also, is it just me, or does everybody look like in Act 2 that they aged 10 years instead of 40 years? Moses is one thing, obviously, because he has to have that white beard and that iconic robe. But we go from Moses leaving Egypt to Moses coming back and looking like the only one who's aged. And it makes me wonder, how long was it for each of the characters? I get it, we've had enough time to establish Ramesses' reign and Nefertiti giving him a son that's probably about 10 years old or younger, but was it just 10 years? And she doesn't look like she's aged much other than 10 years. And even Moses' son, Gershom, looks like he's 10 years. And that's another inaccuracy. Moses hid in Midian for 40 years. Prince of Egypt, I can believe the passage of time was 40 years. So they don't give specifics. They give you montage after montage, specifically through the song Through Heaven's Eyes. So I have no nitpick on the timeline for that one. And for anybody who has done the math, yes, this would mean that Moses came back to Egypt when he was 80 years old. And I'm pretty sure that even Ramesses by then would have been 80 or so. Or older. But how come Nefertiti and her son are young? Also, I did say this about Moses already, but one of the things that I was not too fond of personally was that Moses was already a leader. I guess some people like it and so forth, but Moses was a mumbler, a stutterer. When he pleads to the Lord in Exodus 4 verse 10, Moses said to the Lord, "Pardon your servant, Lord. I have never been eloquent, neither in the past nor since you have spoken to your servant. I am slow of speech and tongue." So it's very likely that he either mumbled, stuttered, a little bit of both. And I think Ben Kingsley captured that amazingly in the other Moses that I was talking about earlier. But so did Val Kilmer. He didn't capture the stuttering part or the mumbling part that much, but he did capture the every man who was called by God in a unique situation. So kudos to that. With Charlton Heston, what I got was, "I'm already strong, but God made me stronger," which, okay, that happens too, but not with Moses. And on top of that, is it just me or is Aaron kind of useless in this version? Because Moses can already speak for himself. There's a moment in Exodus 4:14 where after Moses pleaded with God, "Send somebody else, not me," then the Lord's anger burned against Moses and he said, "What about your brother Aaron the Levite? I know he can speak well. He is already on his way to meet you and he will be glad to see you. You shall speak to him and put words in his mouth. I will help the both of you speak and teach you what to do." And yes, I give credit. John Carradine sounds like a proper Aaron. He sounds like the kind of guy who would be almost like Moses' prophet in a way, or Moses' mouthpiece. He really sounds like it. He carries the authority, like you said, movie fan. But Moses can speak for himself in this one, apparently. And that leads to Prince of Egypt, where Aaron's completely pointless, and he's pretty much not used at all. Moses literally speaks for himself. I guess one of the reasons for that license was because they wanted it to be about the conflict between two brothers, not two brothers and a stepbrother. But to be fair, sometimes you gotta take artistic licenses in this, and for what they did with that artistic license, it was all right. And there's one more inaccuracy I gotta talk about, and it's the moment where Moses comes down from the mountain and confronts everybody with the golden calf. And it's not just inaccuracy, it's also, you could say, a cinema sins moment.
"Woe unto thee, O Israel! You have sinned a great sin in the sight of God. You are not worthy to receive these Ten Commandments."
Let me repeat that moment again, in case you missed it.
"You are not worthy to receive these Ten Commandments."
Ten Commandments were for moments like this and to prevent moments like this. I get this is a condensed time capsule, so they don't know the commandment until Moses comes down with this commandment. So of course they're worshiping the calf before they see the first and second commandments, which are, "Thou shalt not put any gods before me," and "Thou shalt not create unto thee a graven image." The problem that I have with this moment, and those words are one. The Ten Commandments were received a little bit before the golden calf was set up. The Ten Commandments, you can find them in Exodus chapters 19 and 20 when they first are presented to God and they say, "We can't face God. Go speak to him, Moses, just you." Then in Exodus 32, that's when they get the idea to create the golden calf, because he was still on Mount Sinai at the time. And they said to Aaron, "Come, make unto us gods who will go before us. And this fellow Moses who brought us out of Egypt, we don't know what has happened to him." And yes, Aaron consented to making the golden calf. But here's what happened when Moses came down from the mountain. "Go down from this mountain. Your people, the people you brought out from the land of Egypt, have done a terrible sin. They have turned away from what I commanded them and have made unto themselves an idol cast in the shape of a calf. They have bowed to it and sacrificed to it and have said, 'These are your gods, Israel, who have brought you out of Egypt.'" So when Moses came down from the mountain, here's what really happened. Exodus 32, verse 15 and so forth. "Moses turned and went down the mountain with the two tablets of the covenant in his hands. They were inscribed on both sides, front and back. The tablets were the work of God. The writing was the work of God engraved on tablets. When Joshua heard the noise of the people shouting, he said to Moses, 'There is the sound of war in camp.' Moses replied, 'It is not the sound of victory. It is not the sound of defeat. It is the sound of singing that I hear.' When Moses approached the camp and saw the calf and the dancing, his anger burned, and he went and threw the tablets out of his hands, breaking them into pieces at the foot of the mountain. And then he took the calf the people made and burned it in the fire. Then he ground it into powder and scattered it on the water and made the Israelites drink it. He said to Aaron, 'What did these people do that you led them into such a great sin?' 'Do not be angry with me, my lord,' Aaron answered. 'You know how prone these people are to evil. They said to me, "Make gods who will go before us. As for this fellow Moses who brought us up out of the land of Egypt, we don't know what has happened to him." So I told them, 'Whoever has any gold or jewelry, take it off.' They gave me the gold and I threw it into the fire and out came this calf." That is literally what he said, by the way. That is just part one of what has happened. And yes, he does also ask who is on the Lord's side. And the ones who are on the Lord's side join Moses while the rest of them stay there and ultimately die, but not by the earth swallowing them up. That comes much, much later. And that was reserved, like I said, for Korah, Dathan, and Abiram. The rest of them often would suffer terrible, terrible punishments each time that they turned against the Lord. But Korah, Dathan, and Abiram had the worst of it. And I get why Cecil B. DeMille condensed those moments together, because the movie was already very long and it would be even longer to show the entire trip through the desert. So we have other Moses movies for that. But I've never liked that one moment where Moses has said, "You are not worthy of these commandments," because the commandments were there to prevent moments like that. So sorry, Cecil B. DeMille. You failed on that one.
And now we come to the part where we all tally up as to who is going to win this dare to compare. For me, I think both movies are quite equal. Because, you know, the Ten Commandments, it's got its epic story and its epic, and I mean epic, cast of characters. Some very good special effects for the time. And not to mention being filmed on location. Some beautiful costumes and amazing props, and of course Cecil B. DeMille's masterful directing, as well as the music that was used in the film. And at the same time, you got Prince of Egypt, which is a great musical, no doubt about that. The lyrics, they fit the characters, they fit what's going on in the situation. The animation is supreme, the actors are excellent, and I gotta admit, even I just love Val Kilmer's portrayal of God too. It's really good. And, you know, I just love being able to see the plagues play out. And, you know, one of my favorite songs was definitely the plague song. I love how it's done with that choir. Absolutely fantastic. And, of course, both of them definitely prevail in acknowledging that they did take an artistic license. And one key thing, they were both true to the source material and very respectful to it as well. And that's why I deem both of these films equal. Because, you know, to go from 1956 to tell a story of such biblical proportion and to make it work for that time with the kind of special effects that they had, it's incredible. And of course, to remake it in 1998 with great musical numbers, great cast of characters, great animation, and a great new take on a classic story, what's not to like about them? One served its purpose back in the 50s, and the other served its purpose back in the 90s. With both movies, you can enjoy them equally. Now, I tend to lean a little bit more towards the Ten Commandments, because I love classic movies. It's no secret. However, I do absolutely adore The Prince of Egypt. This is one of the few remakes that I actually like. But this was made during a time when remakes were done right. And, you know, they put their heart and soul into their work. And they didn't do it just to make a quick buck. Unlike nowadays. So that's why I love The Prince of Egypt, too. And it's because of this, that's why I think they're both equal.
As much as I love Ten Commandments for the diverse characters that they have and the very interesting subplots that combine with the main plot, I have to go with The Prince of Egypt, honestly, because the dynamic of the brothers just makes the entire difference. And then, of course, the music, the songs, the way it carries the story, and the way the story presents itself, and the way they present God, and the way they present the effects, which I think are groundbreaking in their own right. And it was in a way that had never been done before. So I have to say Prince of Egypt for this, but I still love Ten Commandments, still.
Now, my pick would have to be The Prince of Egypt. Like I said, it's been years since I've last seen The Ten Commandments, and I'm sure it's a great movie with a well-expanded story and pretty good effects for the time. But still, The Prince of Egypt is my absolute favorite version of the Exodus story. Yes, the story is very straight, with several interesting plot points here and there. The animation by DreamWorks is spectacular, whether being done with 2D hand-drawn animation with a bit of CGI effects thrown in. The characters are all memorable, and I like the brotherly relationship between Moses and Ramses. The voice acting is fantastic, especially when it comes to Val Kilmer. And the songs by Stephen Schwartz are incredible. Also, I think The Prince of Egypt is an excellent film to watch if you want to introduce your children to the Exodus story. And trust me, that's what I would do if I ever gained a family of my own.
I would give The Ten Commandments a 6.5 out of 10 and a bronze medal, whereas The Prince of Egypt gets a 9.5 out of 10 and a gold medal. While The Ten Commandments isn't really a movie I'd watch over and over and over again, it's still a movie I'll check out every once in a while. But as for The Prince of Egypt, I've seen it a million times as a kid, and I'm gonna watch it a million times more. The Prince of Egypt is a great film for kids and adults of any age.
In my opinion, even that The Ten Commandments is a great movie with the excellent cast as the characters, great use of special effects, brilliant music, and the plot, as I mentioned before, is very well told, especially the side plots, I say that The Prince of Egypt deserves that crown because it is an absolute masterpiece. It has an incredible cast as the voice of the characters, artistic animation, brilliant special effects, beautifully powerful music, memorable songs, and an epic plot. In conclusion, I say that The Prince of Egypt is the best movie that tells the story of Moses and how he frees the Hebrew slaves from Egypt. Without a doubt, this is my favorite anime movie from DreamWorks. And I say that this is the perfect movie to watch in April. This movie is a work of art that it's definitely worth watching. And I hope that someday that The Prince of Egypt will be part of the Criterion Collection. So with all that said, the winner in this Dare to Compare goes to The Prince of Egypt.
So, what do you guys think? Do you prefer The Ten Commandments? Do you prefer The Prince of Egypt? Or like me, do you like them both? I want to thank my friends Bonnie from Joy Unicycle, Joshua Oro, the Mustang Prince, Alpha Lion Simba, of course, and Johnathan, the reviewer from Jay's Watch, for helping me out on this one. Because to tell a story like this, I knew I couldn't have done it without him. And I'm glad they were here for this.
Movie Fan, thanks for having me for this collaboration.
I would like to thank Movie Fan, Bonnie from Joy Unicycle, Alpha Lion Simba, and Joshua Oro, the Mustang Prince, for inviting me to be part of this special episode of Dare to Compare. I have to emphasize again that I love both The Prince of Egypt and its prequel, Joseph, King of Dreams. I wish that DreamWorks could do more hand-drawn anime movie adaptations of these kind of stories. I have made a petition at change.com for DreamWorks to make more hand-drawn anime movies based on the Bible. Please sign, share, and support the petition if you agree with me. The link is in the description below.
Yeah, this was an awesome time, guys. This was really a lot of fun. Hopefully we can do something like this again.
I'd like to thank Movie Fan, Johnathan, Bonnie, and Joshua for letting me join.
Because just like the movies themselves, this was a review of biblical proportions.
Joy Unicycle.
Mustang Power.
Alpha Lion Simba. Out.
I'm Johnathan, the reviewer from Jay's Watch, and thanks for watching.
This is Movie Fan signing off. But before we go, we want to say one thing. In the words of Ramesses the Great, so let it be written.
So let it be done.
Oh.